गुड मॉर्निंग डियर स्टूडेंट्स,
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
होप यू ऑल डूइंग वेल।
यस सर।
ओके, टुडे वी शैल डिस्कस इंग्लिश लैंग्वेज टीचिंग मेथड्स एंड दिस कम्स अंडर ELT, इंग्लिश लैंग्वेज टीचिंग। वी हैव डेलिबरेटली कैप्ट दिस यूनिट इन योर सिलेबस because it is assumed that most of you would take teaching as your career. So these methods and approaches that we are going to discuss are going to help you in your teaching career. We shall start with the translation method because this is the oldest method and that's why it is called as the classical method of English language teaching. Considered to be the oldest, not as far as English language teaching is concerned, but in fact, I must say that irrespective of any language, if anyone wanted to learn any foreign language, then he or she would resort to this method. Or say, learn the foreign language through the translation method. However, there are many methods. Now there have been improvements over the methods, like this one is the oldest. We have the direct method, we have audiolingual method, we have different approaches also, like situational approach, we have communicative language teaching as well. We shall take them up one by one, but now we begin with the translation method. Now, as the name suggests, translation, so you can very well guess that this is about translation method. That means the English language is taught through translation. This can be assumed, yeah, like you can very well guess, this is the method of English language teaching. Here, you know, we are concerned with English language teaching only, ELT. We are not concerned with other languages like Arabic, Persian, Sanskrit, French or Spanish for that matter. We shall talk about only English language teaching. So this is translation method. So you can assume, as I was saying, that here English is being taught through translation. And you know, like while I'm talking about translation, then I'm taking North India there, in fact, there in my mind, where, you know, Hindi is spoken as the mother tongue, where Hindi is or happens to be the mother tongue of the people here in North Indian states like MP, UP, Rajasthan, Haryana and all. Okay, so we begin with the translation method. Is it fine?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Sir, I have a question. Is there any perfect method for teaching English?
Okay, you are asking me right in the beginning. In fact, I thought, you know, like we would discuss all the methods and then I would be asking which method do you find as the perfect method. Okay, before we come to the translation method, we can discuss if there is any perfect method of English language teaching. This is your question?
Yes, sir.
Okay. In fact, I must say that there is no perfect method of teaching English as a second language. And so it will be wrong for any teacher to adhere to one method or the other method and be dogmatic. Because, you know, all these methods, whether it is translation method, bilingual method or direct method, they all have their demerits. So we cannot stick to any one single method and be dogmatic. Okay. Hence our approach in this regard should be eclectic and pragmatic. We should be practical. If you think that, you know, this method suits our students, then we should adopt that method. Isn't that? Like, if you think that my students can understand through direct method, then I would say that direct method is the best method. But if I feel that my students are not that good at English, if I teach them through direct method, they won't understand, then what should I do? I should teach them through translation method or through bilingual method. So a good teacher cannot sell his freedom and be a slave to any method, whatever be its merits. You know, they are, all methods have their merits and demerits. Even if, there are a number of merits of any method, that doesn't mean that you just adhere to that particular method. So a teacher should select features of any method which he finds effective in particular circumstances. Circumstances, you know, matter a lot. Suppose you are teaching in a, say, in a school of rural background, there you cannot teach through direct method. Why? Because the students are not that good at English. So you have to, in fact, you know, follow the translation method there. And suppose you are teaching in some public school or some, say, good university where students are good at English, who can communicate well, who understand English very well, then you can follow the direct method. Again, you know, I would say that adapt, don't adopt. Just remember this phrase. Adapt. Okay, don't adopt. Like, we shouldn't adopt any single method, any particular method, as the ultimate method. No method is ultimate method, in fact. So, adapt. We should adapt the method according to the circumstances. The kind of stuff we have, the kind of students we have there in our classroom or there in the college or the university that we teach in. So what should be our criterion? Adapt. And don't adopt. This is what a teacher should do. Now, you know, I shall be telling you, in fact, a few tactics also of good teachers, because you are all going to be teachers in future. You are all would be teachers. So, you know, now we have a kind of repo, you are senior ones, you will soon be stepping into your practical life. So I should be discussing how can you make yourself a good teacher. Okay, so you know, there are a number of factors which affect our choice of material and techniques. Like, such factors may be the objectives of teaching English. What is the objective? Are you teaching parts of speech, or say prepositions, articles for that matter? Is the objectives, what objectives do you have of teaching English, or say the class from which your teaching is started? Because you know, like, some of you would like to teach in primary school, some of you would go to school, some of you would make PGT teachers, you know, like PGT, trained graduate, PGT, postgraduate, and some of you become lecturers in the colleges and universities. So it depends, you know, the class from which the teaching is started. Your teaching varies from class to class. It's just not the same. When you teach young students, then your teaching is different. And when you teach senior ones, the way I'm teaching, my teaching is different. Now, you know, I can, in fact, follow or adopt the direct method, and I must. Why? Because you are senior students and it is expected of you that whatever I teach in English, you would understand it. I hope you wouldn't like expect me to speak in the mother tongue. But suppose, you know, you are teaching the young ones in a rural background school, then you need to follow the translation method or the bilingual method. And even the age, the ability and capacity of students also matter much. Age, I said, the ability. Some students are good at English. They are, you know, they have got a good grasp. They easily follow. So you have to keep the capacity also of your students, the ability of your students. And even you know, ability and training of the teacher also matters much. Like, some students, you know, who are taught through Hindi medium, they themselves have a very shaky foundation of English. They themselves, you know, are not good at communicative skills. They cannot speak well. So here I must say that ability and training of the teacher also matters much. If you cannot yourself speak English, then how are you going to impart knowledge through English, through the direct method? And besides that, the availability of aids. Like, we have audiovisual aids. If you have audiovisual aids available in your schools or in your colleges, then you can take this sort to audiovisual aids. You ought to use, you must use. Even the size of the class matters. You know, here, I mean, as far as translation method is concerned, you can have a big class. Okay, students can understand. But if suppose you are teaching through direct method, then, and the class happens to be a very big, I don't think, you know, this method, the direct method, is going to be successful. So there if the class happens to be big, then you need to teach through translation method. If the students aren't that good at English, but if you have a small class, because you know in direct method, one-to-one attention is required. One-to-one attention is required. You can give that one-to-one attention only when you have a small number of students in your class. Okay, a small number of students. Say a class consists of say 25 to 30 students or 40 students at the most. If they are beyond this range, then it is difficult to handle the direct approach or direct method of language teaching. And even the location of the school, I must say, you know, it matters a lot. Like whether it's when the school is located in a rural area or say in the urban one. Suppose if it is in the urban one, then the students happen to know English. Why? Because they come from educated families, English is spoken at their homes, so they know English. But if you know they come from the rural background and your school is situated in the rural area, the location is rural, the people around are rural, okay, agricultural based population is there, then like you won't find English speaking people over there. They might not be that good at English. English might be alien to them. Okay, so there you ought to teach through the translation method. I hope you know I am able to answer your question. Your question was like, which method do you think is the best method? So I'm trying to say, no method is in fact the perfect method. No method is in fact the ultimate method. Our method of teaching will differ accordingly as we are teaching English to say 7 years old student, 11 years old student, or say 23 years old student, the age group you are in. Okay, we have here students from say 21 to 25 years of age. So it also depends, you know, like the age group that you're teaching. Now, since you are the mature ones, so I can handle the topic in English. Means I can follow the direct approach. Not only that, I can discuss even difficult topics, philosophical topics for that matter. Why? Because you're quite mature and you can easily comprehend that. So methods that may be successful in highly technologically advanced countries like Japan, America, or say England, may not be that suitable in India, because you know we lack gadgets. We do not have gadgets. Even in our college, in our university, we don't have gadgets available there. And even if you know we get the gadgets, there is nobody. We do not have technical personnel to handle them. They are not available. We keep asking our principal or the vice chancellor that please make these aids available, or please make the people, the technical staff available, but they don't listen to it. And that is why, you know, even if you get them, you are not able to use them. So one should know how to use the technical gadget also, audiovisual aids and all. The social background also poses language learning and teaching challenges. Social background, yes. You know, if students come from, educated background, for example, if they are from the urban background, then they understand English, whereas if they come from the rural background, if they do not come from the education, if they do not have educated parents, if the parents are illiterate, if the parents are not educated, then you cannot follow the direct approach of English language teaching. I'm talking about the initial stages. Later, you know, in the senior stage, at your stage, we ought to follow the direct method of English language teaching. For instance, students in rural areas who have no opportunity to listen to spoken English or have no access to the internet are at disadvantageous position as compared to the urban students. Now, you know, like our students, since you are all urban students, our college is situated in the city, and the city is quite advanced, so you have access to the internet, and you have in gadgets available there in your college and there in the department, so we can make use of that. So it all, you know, this also varies. So you will have to keep the circumstances, you will have to keep the school, you will have to keep the location in your mind before choosing any method. Again, I would say that there is no perfect method of teaching English. In fact, you know, we strive and continue to strive to evolve a perfect pedagogical method on scientific evidence. However, we have not yet been able to say claim any specific method of teaching as the perfect, scientifically based and ultimate method of language teaching. Okay, like we couldn't evolve in so many years. Like no linguist can claim that this method is the ultimate method. Follow this method, and if you're following this method, your students are going to learn English very well. No, we couldn't evolve. There isn't any perfect method. Every method has both merits and demerits. Therefore, the best method is one which is neither teacher-based. You know, some methods are teacher-based, where teacher is active. For example, the translation method. This method is teacher-based. Why? Because teacher is active and the students are just the passive listeners. Whatever teacher teaches them, they listen to him. They follow him. So this is teacher-based method. And as far as direct method is concerned, I would say that is that it is learner-based. Or say situational approach to teaching, or audiolingual approach to teaching, or an oral approach to language teaching, a communicative language to teaching. All these approaches and methods, they can be called student-centered methods. Why? Or they can even be called the interactive methods. So what I was trying to say, the method shouldn't be neither teacher-based nor student-centered, but learning-centered, where learning is important, where students can learn in a better way. So it should be learning-centered. It should neither be teacher-centered nor student-centered, but it should be learning-centered, exploiting the best of available resources, means whatever resources that you have. And if you don't have the resources, then you should try to give the best of your experiences, your teaching to your students. So how, you know, if you are a good teacher, then you can even do well, give the best of yourself, even in limited resources, right? Making maximum use of your imagination in guiding and captivating attention of the students through the learning process. The teacher, the teachers have to be flexible enough to adapt to various factors, especially the quality of students they have. Because, you know, in every school and in every college, we do not have the same quality of students. Okay? The quality of students vary. Isn't that?
Yes.
Okay, this is dropped, so you may change it. Yeah. So, you know, quality of students vary. So we cannot adhere to any single method. We have to adopt, don't adapt. We have to adapt, don't adopt. Again, I would say. So in fact, you know, we were going to begin the translation method. Since you asked me a question that is there any perfect method of English language teaching? So I was trying to tell you, no, my dear students, there isn't any perfect method of English language teaching. You have to select yourself. Your approach has to be eclectic. You have to be pragmatic. And that's why I said adapt and don't adopt. If you think that translation is useful, then teach through translation method. If you think that your students can handle, understand through the direct method, then teach through the direct method. I hope this is clear to you, the answer you have got.
Yes, sir.
So what is the take-home line here? The take-home line is that there isn't any perfect method of teaching. And that is why your approach has to be eclectic. Your approach has to be pragmatic. Pragmatic, you know, we already done pragmatics. Now, here I'm using the English language word pragmatic. What does it mean? Practical. Okay, practical. So your approach has to be practical. The pragmatic approach.